It's my pleasure this morning to introduce the Merit Systems Protection Board Chairman, Susan Brennan. She was nominated by President Obama in 2009, and since her appointment has been very proactive in forming relationships with organizations throughout the federal government. FMA was honored to be asked to provide input for MSPB's research agenda, and it's my pleasure to introduce Chairman Brennan to you today.
Good morning.
Morning.
This reminds me of the union convention. It's kind of laid out the same way, so we can talk about that later. Thank you to Madam President and to the Federal Managers Association for this opportunity to address you at your national convention and to celebrate your theme, Federal Managers Turning Policy into Action. On behalf of the other board members, the Vice Chair Ann Wagner, the member Mrs. Mary Rose, and our Executive Director Steve Lenkhart and our Director of Policy and Evaluation Dr. Crum, who are in the back here today, it is a great privilege to bring you our thoughts on the numerous challenges facing you in your daily life and to how you improve effectiveness and capitalize on workplace talents to drive performance. In other words, how to excel as a manager. With the mounting budget deficit and the increasing need to cut expenditures, your role is ever more complicated, because we all need to do more with less. Fewer people, less money, the retirement tidal wave looming in the not too distant future, and a vote today potentially on whether we shut down next week. Your role is ever more complicated. And what I want to say is however, in these difficult budgetary times and political times, your role should never be underestimated or undervalued. You are a key stakeholder in our community. I do have great admiration for what you do day in, day out. You are not an average federal employee who is generally covered by a collective bargaining agreement and represented by a union. Nor are you SES or political leadership tasked with the ability to create policy. You are in the middle, sometimes wedged between two competing interests and voices. You are, in every way, the single linchpin tasked to carry out the mission and vision of management while guiding, inspiring, and leading those who report to you. Yours is perhaps the hardest job in federal government, something that we recognize at the MSPB. Last summer, we issued a report entitled A Call to Action, Improving First-Level Supervision of Federal Employees. We found, and this should be of no surprise to anybody here, that supervision itself is a major change. We found that promotion in the federal sector is often based on technical competence rather than the ability to deal with employee personalities and employee conflict about the workplace. In other words, the skill of supervising. Supervisors go from doing the work to getting the work done through others, and that is challenging indeed. So today, I offer you four guidelines on your journey as a federal manager in turning policy into action, particularly in the economic landscape before us. First, in order to turn policy into action, one has to understand what the policy is and how it supports your mission. Did you know that a mission statement is now required by the GIPRA Modernization Act of 2010? And that same act strongly encourages a vision statement as well. Do you know what your agency's mission statement is? Or your subcomponent or your subdivision's mission statement? They could be slightly different. And perhaps in these tough times, we may be required to redefine that mission because of cutbacks and shifts in priorities to meet budgetary limitations. So know that mission, but it's not enough just to know that mission. You have to be able to articulate that mission in such a fashion that those who work for you and with you can visualize and see how they fit, support, and share that mission statement. In my previous life, I've dealt with dozens and dozens of agencies. each with their own unique work culture and work values. Some are more unique than others. Those who are truly unique, you know who you are. But the workforces that truly shone were the ones who were best able to define their mission in the simplest yet most passionate terms. So let me call a couple of you out. Is there anybody here from the VA? How about the Forest Service? Well, these are two particular agencies to me that stood out because these agencies, they knew their mission and they were able to put the mission first in their negotiations, in their daily business, in rising above disputes. For instance, the Forest Service, their mission, caring for the land and serving people. The VA, to care for him who shall have borne the battle and for his widow and his orphan by serving and honoring the men and women who are Americans, veterans. So even in the tough times when employees and unions and managers didn't agree, and they still don't agree in these two agencies, I saw a commitment to the end goal, which put a focus on the mission above the minutia and the ability to get beyond daily disputes so that the mission was not only preserved, but advanced. Second, you know your mission, you can articulate your mission. Turning policy into action now requires getting the word out, and not just to the public and to your sister agencies or to Congress, but to your employees. For those that support your work and your performance, let them know how each is integral to the mission and the policy's success. In order to turn words into deeds, policy into action, we must engage our employees on a continual basis, as Madam President so advised that we've been looking towards at the MSPB. It really is work inclusion and work investment at its very best. A few years ago, we issued a report entitled The Power of Federal Employee Engagement. We define such engagement as a heightened connection between employees, their organization, their work, and the people they work for or with, and that's me and that's you. When employees are engaged, our report finds that the agencies derive positive, measurable results. In addition, they see less use of sick leave, quicker return to work following injury. Why? Because people like coming to work and they're committed to their work. In other words, that translates for all of us into more productive time. And since supervisors are the link between leadership and employees, your actions, our actions, strongly and directly impact employee engagement. And to this end, turning policy into action, we found some basic strategies that you can use, that we can use to enhance that engagement, and I commend them to you today. First, make work meaningful by explaining agency goals and clearly linking those goals to individual goals, which means you have to get to know the employees one-on-one, engage in their workforce, find out what motivates them, and use that motivating factor tied into the agency. I'll give you an example, okay? I'm a numbers cruncher. I happen to work for the Forest Service. But the goal is not crunching numbers. The goal and how I support the mission is maybe I'm keeping track of the numbers so I know how much timber is cut, so the land is cared for, caring for the land, and can be sold. So that's your tie to the agency. Second, sounds easy, but communicate often and honestly in person whenever possible, sharing good news and bad news. I mean, back in the day, we had meetings. Back in the day, we picked up the phone. Now, you don't have to talk to anybody all day. You can email and text. Let's try and get out of that mold if you can. Understand that individual work styles vary and that not all employees have to work the same in order to be great. Here's the obvious. Frequent feedback and coaching, even if the feedback is informal. Offering growth opportunities, encouraging creativity, thinking outside the box. Recognizing contributions, both publicly and privately. And treat employees as business partners by holding them accountable for the outcome. while empowering them to decide how the work is done. And finally, make it a safe place to express opinions, whether confidentially or not, but make it as encourage it. And also always, always allow for honest mistakes, but because they can and will happen. Engagement is tied to my third point, which is something near and dear to my heart as well as that of the Obama administration, and that is transparency. As you know, the President signed an executive order on open government and transparency late in 2009, and we at the MSPB have taken this order close to heart, infusing not only many of our internal but our external efforts during the last 16 months. Within MSPB, we have a tradition of an open comment period for policy changes so that senior staff and directors can express interests and concerns. But we are a small agency, so it is easier. Larger agencies, a little bit harder. We find that everybody brings something to the table and that the table benefits from our dialogue. Outside of MSPB, transparency has been a hallmark of some of our major efforts during the last year. The first being the return to oral arguments over significant legal issues with government-wide or agency-wide impact. Coupled with oral argument, we also frequently do calls for amicus briefs. And those amicus briefs are calls to the public, to the parties, to the agencies, to the stakeholders, to comment how these significant legal issues will impact your world and how you think they should be interpreted. And finally, return to Sunshine Act meetings, asking our stakeholders to suggest and comment on our future study program. Some of these practices are resurrected from over 20 years of neglect, and some of them are entirely new. But all of our actions or deeds are based on our mission, and that is to serve the public interest by protecting merit systems principles and safeguarding a civil service free of prohibited personnel practices. Which leads me to my final guideline in turning policy into action. You, me, we all have to have the credibility to pull it off. And that means our credibility. If you're going to talk the talk, you got to walk the walk. If we are going to advocate a certain behavior, we have to exemplify that behavior. This rings particularly true at the MSPB. As you know, we have essentially two statutory functions. The first is to adjudicate cases within our jurisdiction. And the second is to report to the President, to Congress, and to the stakeholders on the health and well-being of the federal civil service. These reports often become the basis of legislative and regulatory reform, giving us the opportunity to suggest and advance change in our workforce. In the future, with input from our stakeholders, including FMA, we will be studying such controversial subjects such as violence in the workplace, how to measure performance, and your perspectives, as well as the employees' perspectives, about your role as supervisors and managers, as suggested by FMA. So you, the people in this room, will have the ability to shape that report. But we can't just make recommendations for the future without applying the lessons learned internally to our own employees. Again, talking the talk, walking the walk. Recently, we overhauled our strategic plan to now measure how many of those recommendations we make in our reports that we actually bring in-house and apply to our own employees. During that overhaul, we added a new strategic goal, which is to advance the public's interest in education and promotion of a stronger merit systems, adherence to merit principles, and the prevention of prohibited personnel practices. I keep talking about merit principles because there are 9 merit principles. These 9 principles are the foundation of federal employment. They are what makes federal civil service civil. Employment determines solely on qualifications. Fair and equitable treatment without discrimination. Equal pay for equal work, retention, promotion, and separation based solely on performance. Protection from partisan politics and protection against reprisal from whistleblowing. What is a system, a workforce, if it cannot be founded on these basic principles of fairness? We as managers should exemplify these standards and demonstrate in our ideals, our actions, and exhibit them constantly. We hope that others will mirror our example and follow suit. However, not every employee can or will, and that's where performance-based and adverse actions come into play. These cases make up approximately 40% of our docket, and we literally issue thousands and thousands of decisions every year on performance, on employee performance. These cases can also highlight how you deal with problem employees, because if you don't deal with a problem employee, your morale will suffer and your mission will be jeopardized. So over the last year, a number of concepts have emerged, and I would like to share them with you today. First, and perhaps foremost, the hardest and the easiest, is treat similarly situated employees in a similar fashion, particularly when it comes to performance and adverse actions. And if you don't, have a good reason why. Because if you don't have that good reason, the door is open to claims of discrimination, retaliation, and the commission of prohibited personnel practices. Second, use progressive discipline, particularly when the infraction is slight and the potential for rehabilitation is evident. Third, and this is the mirror of the second, the seriousness of the offense or behavior often determines, is the most important factor in determining the amount of discipline. In other words, the punishment that fits the crime. Fourth, this is an increasing trend that we're seeing at the MSPB. More whistleblowing claims. The law here is highly complex, and the outcome is mostly determined on the facts in each case, so no two cases look alike. But having said that, let me offer you a general guideline. If you are confronted with an employee who's claiming whistleblower protection, ask yourself whether you would take that same proposed personnel action which you're contemplating, absent that disclosure. Are you treating this employee more harshly than others? And if you are, do you have a reason why? And if that reason is linked to that whistleblowing disclosure, then perhaps you ought to reach out to your HR, your LR specialist, and contemplate whether you want to go down this road. And finally, let me give a shout out to all those HR specialists out there. Here's the final rule, absolutely crucial. Listen to the advice of your HR specialists. And listen to them good and well. Let them know that you want their advice, even though you may not agree with them. Because they are there to guide you and to keep you and your agency out of trouble. Always ask, what is the right way to this result? Rather than, how do I get around the rule? Because trying to get around the rule, again, opens the door to claims of discrimination, retaliation, and the commission of prohibited personnel practices. So let me close by saying in today's climate, while they're voting on our future on the Hill right now, where missions change and the agency's priorities shift, and the government and the public actually debate what our role will be in the future, that the merit principles should be at the heart of that debate. Not only are the merit principles about fundamental fairness, but the principles are at the core of good government. Following these principles means promoting merit, means promoting morale, and ultimately the efficiency of your performance. And as you return to this convention and return back to your daily life, I leave you with two objectives, which are essentially mirrors of one another. First, at a minimum, when turning policy into action, do no harm of the merit principles. Don't discriminate, don't retaliate, make your decisions based on qualifications and performance. And second, if you can, advance these principles in your decisions and your deeds when turning policy into action. Have a good convention. Thank you.
Thank you.
Has a questions, so if any of you have questions, Jesse has a mic right there. I encourage you to use the mic because it is hard to hear up here with the fan right behind us.
So I was told before I got on stage that your last speaker, there's a trick that I should use next time if I want to avoid questions, which is as soon as the speech is over, leave. So I throw myself at your mercy.
I'm Doug Harrell from Social Security Administration.
Hi, Doug.
It's such a large organization that's nationwide. I'm concerned about one of the points that you made about standardizing discipline. You know, you've got managers at the lowest level that only supervise a small group of people. Is there any looking to a regional standardization, or is it supposed to be a national standardization?
There's a line of cases that we have, and there really is no standardization. It's treating similarly situated people in a similar fashion. So maybe you're over here on the West Coast and somebody else is out in Baltimore. You do similar work, you do similar types. The infraction is based on the same rule. You should be getting, in theory, the same amount of discipline as somebody on the East Coast. So there's not a every set of facts is different. So no one set of facts is you know, controlling. And let me throw in another wrench. Our reviewing court is the Federal Circuit. And in 2009, they handed down a decision which said that just because you're in two different chains of command is not outcome determinative. You have to have a reason for treating similarly situated people differently. So maybe the reason is, well, this person knows the role well, this person has been, you know, working here for 30 years, they've gotten progressive discipline. We're going to treat this guy a little more harshly than we're going to treat the guy on the other coast, because this is a new employee, just learning, you know, possibility of rehabilitation. This is all the Douglas factors things that you have to deal with.
Just to comment, as a practical matter, it seems to be taking forever to get approval to take simple actions, because everybody's got to check with everybody else nationwide to see that you know, what is proposed is standard or appropriate.
I don't know if it's, I'm not sure you can, I'm not going to speak for the board, I'm just going to speak as an advocate now from my past life. I'm not sure you can standardize discipline just because the facts are different, so they're very unique to each case. I mean, you should, I'll tell a story. One of our turning point cases is a case called Wabecki versus DHS. And in it, the guy was a FAM, he was a federal air marshal. And he was nailed for soliciting prostitution while on a layover, no pun intended. But so he got fired. Through his discovery process, they were able to find two other FAMs who solicited prostitution and only got 14 days. So when the case came before the MSPB, the judge made multiple credibility determinations. But she said, you know, hey, you haven't come up with a reason why these people in Germany got 14 days and this guy in Hawaii got removed. So she mitigated the penalty to 14 days. And that withstood the board scrutiny at our level.
Good morning. Aloha from Hawaii.
Oh. Yay.
The question is, are you seeing an increase in particular types of cases, such as maybe violence in the workplace, maybe not just due to the behavior, but to increase claims or reporting?
There is an increase in your, the Postal Service is bringing a lot of cases to us, and those are restoration cases, you know. That's a big clump. And the other thing I mentioned earlier is there are a lot of whistleblowing cases. And I'm not really sure why. I know that Teresa Chambers was clearly, you know, somebody who set the standard for people to follow. I probably see four or five of them a week, which is a lot. We all know that in the past there had been some new legislation proposed for whistleblowing, which potentially expands the protection for whistleblowers. After 10 years, it still hasn't passed yet. So, but if that passes, it'll change the lay of the land. I will say that not everybody, a lot of people claim to be whistleblowers. It's very, very hard to prove the case because of the law.
Hi, Linda Hill from USAID. My question is kind of strange. We are different in the fact that we have the Foreign Service officers, and as you know, they are the people that also supervise our civil service. I'm finding it very difficult. I'm an administrative officer, and I do all the personnel stuff for the Asia Middle East Bureau within AID. And I'm finding it more difficult that a lot of these Foreign Service officers do not understand the civil service side of things, are constantly going against what they should be and not taking the advice of myself and HR on how to deal with problem employees and stuff. And what they do is they see, oh, I'm only here for 2 years, I'm gonna just pass the problem on to the next person.
Yeah.
How would you deal with these type of managers that basically say, I'm just not going to deal with it, even though they're put in that role as supervising these civil service people?
You know, what's interesting is unlike fine red wine, problem employees don't get better over time. You have to deal with them. I mean, our case law basically says that you have to deal with them effectively and promptly. Otherwise, you know, you've allowed a bad situation to fester, and now your morale's going to sink because everybody's looking at this one person. Why can't you fix this problem? So that's the reality. Let me offer you a possibility, and we would do this for you guys. We'll do some training for you. Your choice. You can use the judges that actually hear these cases and can give you some problems, common problem areas on where these cases, where the agency loses or where the employee loses. That's the first part. The other part of it is that gentleman back there, Dr. Crum, is kind of an expert on the whole range of MSPB options, but it's more in a studies fashion rather than, you know, rules. And but in terms of policy, I mean, I think his department would also be eager to reach out to you guys and have a conversation. The HR community is so undervalued, right, and so underappreciated, but they're really the gatekeepers to, and people should be listening to them. And sometimes if they're not listening to you, then get somebody on the outside. And, you know, we will be your outsiders. Okay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Brian Donnell from Department of Navy. I have a question about, are you looking, is there a push to, well, I see the pendulum swing coming back around to educating managers and first line supervisors in those soft skills that you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Do you look at organizations as a whole and see how they're, first of all, do they have separate funding for that? So what I see is it's real hard to measure the return on investment of, say, leadership club courses when, you know, you don't get the product right away, right out of the gate. So is there a push to look at organizations as a whole and say, how are you succession planning? How are you teaching these skills? And are they sending them to offsites, or are they kind of doing their job while they're learning on computer-based training? Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, there's a, we're getting ready to issue a report. We issued one last year, and there's another one coming out on training competencies. What kind, how do you train, what sorts of things do you train particular supervisors in? John, I don't know if you're ready to talk about something like that, but.
What we do in that report, we talk about how some things are more trainable than others. And we really should leverage our training dollars as best we can to do those things that are both most effective and most needed by the organization. So, what we're seeing is that it really organizations need to prioritize. They need to prioritize around what they see for the future, and supervision is a big piece of that. Unfortunately, I think in the current budget environment, while there was some drive to that in the Congress in the past few years about increasing, for instance, the requirement for supervisory training, it's sort of been lost in terms of emphasis. We're trying to continue to put that emphasis there and say those soft skills, as you mentioned, those competencies that are related to supervision continue to be important and continue to be, in our minds, underdeveloped in many cases, underemphasized, underfunded. So we are out there trying to emphasize the need for that for both now and for the future.
Okay. I think we have time for one more question.
Morning.
Good morning.
Dan Garrison, Department of Defense.
Hey.
I just want to kind of tag on what we've just been talking about. It's kind of a sore spot with me. We have a lot of new supervisors, and without the proper training, now we used to have a very comprehensive training program that included scenario-based training, and it was very intense, and it was mandatory. Now we are giving people computer-based training as they can get it, and these people are relying on their gut instinct and their personality to deal with employee problems. And if that is not the proper way to go about it, they've started now a firestorm with this incident with this employee that could have been something that was, it goes from an ant to an alligator very quickly. So I would advocate that we absolutely need some sort of mandatory training within a very short period of a person becoming a supervisor in order to, if you want to grow that person as a supervisor into a manager, it has to start with that basic training, and if a computer-based training is good, it fills a block, it checks a square, but it is what it is. It's something you can sleep through if you need to. Interactive, intense training they used to have is a far cry away from computer-based training. I think we need to get back to something like that.
Amen. Gotcha. Thank you.
Okay, Chairman, I'd like to thank you so much for joining us this morning and sharing that advice for our managers here. So we really appreciate it. We have a little gift for you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We're going to take a minute here and get a FIA update for everybody. If Robin would come on up.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I want to congratulate all of you. The donations yesterday added up to $2,048. So that's a pretty good first day. Congratulations. But I have even better news than that, because this morning, where are the folks from Chapter 307? Right over there. We had a wonderful donation from the chapter this morning of $12,060. So, big hand there. So your total right now is $3,308. So I have a challenge. Before we get to the final break this afternoon, I would love to be able to get up here and tell you that you have $4,000 in that account. So we've got just about $700 to go. I know there are a lot of people who are waiting till today. And Steve, just to sweeten the deal, has some little chocolates. So anybody who comes out and gives during the next break, there's chocolate. $1,200. So please do come out if you haven't made your donation yet. We've got lots of great raffle prizes that we'll be giving away later on this afternoon. So please do come see us.